Story is one of the most important aspects of a single-player action-adventure game. Often overlooked in the medium, the interactive nature of video games and their sheer complexity means that crafting a strong narrative often isn't given precedence over things like graphical presentation and the fine-tuning of gameplay elements. This is one of the biggest tragedies in the medium, as a good, compelling story not only has the power to elevate the quality of any action-adventure game, and I use that term as an umbrella genre to define pretty much any single-player action or adventure game or any applicable subgenre, but can actually be one of its strongest assets. Metal Gear Solid is a prime example of this philosophy in execution. The brainchild of Hideo Kojima, who was the game's head director, producer, designer, and writer. It was always Kojima's ambition to create a cinematic video game with an elaborate story propelling it forward. What many casual fans may be unaware of is that Metal Gear Solid was actually the third game in the Metal Gear franchise. The first game, simply titled Metal Gear, was released in 1987 for the MSX2, a Japanese home computer system. While this is the game that launched the entire series, established the basic stealth concept of evasion, and introduced some of the most important and iconic characters, most notably Solid Snake and Big Boss, the primitive hardware of the late 1980s meant that the end result fell short of Kojima's lofty ambition. Whether discouraged by his inability to present his ideas through a medium comparable to the spy or action films he fanatically admired, or simply due to the fact that Metal Gear was his first ever project, even the plot, which itself wouldn't have been subjected to hardware restrictions, was nowhere near as deep and well constructed as those found in future games. The sequel, Metal Gear 2 Solid Snake, released in 1990, improves upon the original in every conceivable way. Even if you ignore the graphical and oral improvements that occur naturally as video games become more advanced, the gameplay was sharper, more intricate and stimulating, the characters were more interesting and fleshed out, and the location was better too, putting Snake in the jungles and military bases of Zanzibar Land. The most important thing, especially as it would eventually pertain to Metal Gear Solid, was how Metal Gear 2 showcased a series that was evolving, and evolving rapidly. Metal Gear 2 wasn't just a better game than the original Metal Gear. It showed Kojima and his team at Konami inching closer and closer to finally realizing his ambition, which would eventually manifest itself in Metal Gear Solid. So much so, in fact, that Kojima would steal from his own creation by porting entire plot points and gameplay elements from Metal Gear 2 into Metal Gear Solid. Still, it will be 8 more years until gaming hardware would catch up to Kojima's vision. The very first reveal trailer for Metal Gear Solid was shown at the 1996 Tokyo Game Show. Now, it is common for first trailers of video games to display something a little different to what the final product will ultimately end up as. But the first Metal Gear trailer isn't just some beta footage with rough graphical presentation and unfinished gameplay. It's something almost different entirely. Weird, quirky, and wonderfully Japanese. The first half of the trailer doesn't even show any gameplay at all. Instead, showing us the inside of Konami Studio with a Terminator-like hue and green text flooding the screen. When we get to see some actual gameplay footage, we see an altered, obscure version of what the game would ultimately look like. Enhanced graphically well above actual gameplay footage, a common practice at the time. Many of the game's set pieces are shown here, but are presented in almost a virtual reality-like setting, foreshadowing the Metal Gear Solid Special Missions expansion pack that will come out a year after the game's initial release. The trailer shown at the 1997 E3 event was a much more accurate depiction of what Metal Gear Solid actually became. In fact, the game looks practically finished by this stage. Many of the areas from both the early and latter stages of the game are on show here, while most of the gameplay footage looks identical to the finished product, a few additional pyrotechnics notwithstanding. There are only two things that I found odd about this trailer. The first was the proclamation, "The Legend Returns." Now, the first two Metal Gear games were released before I was born, and I may be wrong about this, but I just have a feeling that the vast majority of people who saw this trailer, as well as the vast majority of people who would ultimately end up playing Metal Gear Solid, wouldn't have played the first two games or have had a clue who Solid Snake was. Bear in mind also that there was an 8-year gap between the release of Metal Gear Solid and Metal Gear 2, which back in the 80s and 90s was an eternity in a medium which was evolving more rapidly at that point in history than at any other time before or since. The other thing I found peculiar about it was the prevalence of the main Metal Gear Solid theme song. That may sound strange, but the theme which now defines the series orally was basically absent from the first MGS game, only really featuring prominently for the first time in the sequel, Metal Gear Solid 2, Sons of Liberty. I always found it strange, given the quality, catchiness, and iconic nature of the theme, that they basically never use it in the finished game. Not that the music in Metal Gear Solid is bad on its own, it most certainly isn't, and we'll get to that later. I always just thought its absence was curious. Anyway, Metal Gear Solid was released on September 3rd, 1998 in Japan, October 21st, 1998 in North America, and February 22nd, 1999 in Europe for the original PlayStation. That the game is a critical success should be a given at this point. Instead, I think we should focus on how different and groundbreaking the game was in a variety of ways. Conceptually, orally, its story, its presentation, its vibe. Metal Gear Solid took all these different facets applicable to the action-adventure genre and games in general, and either shattered the mold set in place by those that came before it, or completely subverted it. Working off the tagline tactical espionage action, MGS was one of the very first true stealth games, and is seen as a pioneer of the genre. The more powerful hardware available to the developers, thanks to the groundbreaking 3D renderings of the PlayStation and other 5th generation consoles, enabled more dynamic and challenging level design, while also facilitating more sophisticated and nuanced enemy AI. The same technology meant that the graphics in general were more realistic. While we were still a generation or two away from the textual nuance and definition we've come to expect from games today, models were much more identifiable and easily recognizable. Things like buildings, people, guns, vehicles, animals, etc. could be verified visually in their three-dimensional forms. Sound design was also significantly more advanced than in previous generations. Previously, the 16-bit consoles generally only allowed for synthesized music and text in lieu of voice acting. But by this generation, not only could you program fully instrumental music into games, but you could utilize voice actors instead of endless scrolling text. These were all elements that Kojima and his team would implement to create his first true masterpiece. Remember how I said earlier that the limited technology of previous consoles prevented him from bringing his vision of a cinematic story-driven stealth action title to life? Well, these barriers were no longer in place, and Kojima took full advantage of the new technology. Before we analyze these facets in greater detail, let's look at the opening sequence of the game as evidence of Kojima's ambition coming to life. The first thing we hear is the opening lines of one of the game's main themes, "The Best Is Yet To Come," sung in full voice. The first thing we see is the foundation of a warehouse, morphing and distorting from the underwater POV. Suddenly, a man in full scuba attire is seen swimming towards the warehouse ledge. We cut to a man giving orders to soldiers decked out in white before boarding a cargo elevator, while the sounds of the elevator alarm and an orchestrated score echo through the speakers. Our protagonist Snake then takes a codec call from his commander, Colonel Campbell, with both characters fully voiced. With the cutscene finished, Snake must sneak past the guards and make his way to the elevator. If you choose to re-enter the water to search for items, your walking will be more labored in response to the physics of being back in the water. Go forward, and you'll have to evade these soldiers. You can crawl under crates, you can hide behind containers and knock on them and get their attention to misdirect them. Step in a puddle, they'll hear the splash and come to investigate. If they spot you, you'll have to run and seek refuge in a hiding place until the heat dies down. Navigate the terrain cleverly or avoid getting killed long enough for the elevator to arrive. You can hop on board and make your way to the surface. As you ascend, another cutscene is triggered. It shows our man removing his scuba gear. Don't worry, he's wearing a sneaking suit underneath. And diving mask, revealing our protagonist, Solid Snake, as the game's title flashes on the screen. Again, as I previously mentioned, this is far from a graphical powerhouse by today's standards, evidenced by the blurry textures of Snake's face. Even still, the fully rendered 3D models and dynamic camera work during the cutscenes, along with the opening credits that run throughout the opening sequence, give the opening a Hollywood blockbuster feel, and set the tone for the rest of the game. While it may be difficult to comprehend now, you just didn't see presentation like this in games back in 1998. While the most enduring part of the game's legacy, and the main crux of this video, is the story. At this point, we only know the bare bones of it. You play as Snake. Your former unit Foxhound, now led by a man named Liquid Snake, have taken over a nuclear weapons disposal facility in Alaska and are holding the DARPA chief and the president of ArmsTech hostage. They're demanding $1 billion and the remains of Snake's former commander and mentor Big Boss from the United States government, threatening nuclear action against the US if their demands are not met. So again, the setup is typical action movie stuff, with the quality and depth of the story not becoming apparent until later on. However, the other qualities of the game were on full display almost immediately. I've spoken enough about the graphics for now, so I'll reference them later on as the video goes on. So instead, let's focus on what you hear instead of what you see. Aside from the story, the second biggest strength at MGS has to be the sound design. Everything about it is just phenomenal. As I said, the first thing you hear is the track The Best Is Yet To Come. Composed by Rika Muranaka and sung by Ifeanyi Farag, it's a beautiful composition which combines Japanese-style instrumentation with an Irish voice singing lyrics in the native Irish tongue. As an Irish man myself, I remember getting a kick out of this, and as someone who now lives permanently in North America, I can see how this meshing of two different styles would have been pleasantly jarring for players. The musical quality doesn't end there though, as the entire game is soundtracked beautifully. The combination of dark, moody, low-tempo techno during stealth sections with dramatic orchestration during fight and chase sequences is critical in establishing the game's atmosphere. It also doesn't hurt that these tracks are very well composed and are memorable and fit in the moments in which they appear perfectly. Just as impressive as the music is the voice acting. Again, not to harp too much on the past here, but voice acting was a relatively new thing in gaming at this time. What was even rarer was a game that was fully voice acted from start to finish. And Metal Gear Solid is a game with a lot of dialogue. And I mean a lot of dialogue. Dispersed across multiple cutscenes which, of course, we will talk about more as we go. One thing that can be appreciated, whether viewed through the lens of history or the current day, is how well the actors for the game's characters were cast. The best and most iconic of all is our protagonist Solid Snake. David Hayter, the man who voiced Snake, was not just perfect for his role, his gravelly voice has gone down as one of the most iconic in gaming history. It will be inconceivable that anyone else would voice this character. So much so that when Konami decided to change voice actors for Metal Gear Solid 5, released almost 20 years on after this game, fans, myself included, found it impossible to accept a new voice behind the character. Even the fact that Hayter was replaced by Keith Sutherland of 24 fame didn't make any difference. Other standouts include Paul Elding as Colonel Campbell, Tazia Valenza as Sniper Wolf, and Patrick Zimmerman as Revolver Ocelot. There is also a light reverb that permeates a good portion of the game. Much of the game takes place in large, open interiors like warehouses, which would have a natural echo in real life. Whether or not it was the intention of the developers to add this in for realism or not, this echo gives the game a special ambience that really adds to the mood of the game. Metal Gear Solid has its own unique vibe, a tense, conspiratorial one that keeps the player engaged and on their toes. And this vibe, along with the sound design, works to the game's advantage. So much so that when they remade Metal Gear Solid 6 years later for the Nintendo GameCube in the form of the Twin Snakes, the new soundtrack, with a more upbeat techno style, actually kind of ruined the vibe of the original. That and the Matrix-inspired cutscenes meant that many players, myself included, still actually prefer revisiting the original PlayStation version over the GameCube remake, in spite of its vastly superior graphics and more dynamic gameplay. When we reach the surface, we get our first real glimpse of the island we'll be exploring, Shadow Moses. Beginning at the base's exterior, we must infiltrate the interior and locate the DARPA chief, Donald Anderson. This sets up a tutorial of sorts. Getting another call from the colonel, he tells us a little bit about the enemy, about our surroundings, how to be stealthy and how to draw attention to ourselves, such as the aforementioned knocking on walls and surfaces, and the fact that we can leave footprints in the snow that the guards will follow. These tutorials, which occur sporadically throughout the game when new mechanics are introduced, are a clever concept but have become something of a meme throughout the years. I can appreciate the fact that Kojima tried to avoid any break in the immersion by having the Colonel explain to you how to perform actions in the game by telling the actual protagonist rather than simply having a tutorial that addresses the player directly. But when he tells Snake to climb a ladder by pressing the action button, it tends to break the fourth wall regardless. In that sense, it completely fails in maintaining the immersion, but it still is just one of those quirky Metal Gear-isms that comes across more charming than anything. They even maintain this tutorial style when it comes to showing you how to save the game, or saving your progress as Mei Ling puts it. In the process, they introduce two new characters, Mei Ling and Naomi, who explain in further detail about Snake's bodysuit, the radar, and how it doesn't work if you're discovered by enemies, explaining the spike in difficulty as the radar jamming. This is where the first major flaws in the game present themselves, and these are the enemy's field of vision and the rigmarole that occurs upon being discovered. The problem with the enemy's field of vision is simple. It's just too small. Represented by blue cones that spread out from their dotted avatars in the radar map, it stretches out no more than 8 feet in front of them. There is a potentially weak storyline explanation for this revealed near the end of the game, but without spoiling it, let me just say it's a long shot at best. When you're discovered by enemy soldiers or cameras, who operate with a comparable field of vision, no explanation given there, you go through an alert phase where, as mentioned, your radar shuts off and enemy personnel start hunting you down. Find a hiding spot or evade them for a while, and they call off the search, going back to their posts as if nothing happened. Now, I've no problem with the concept or the execution per se. They've used the same alert, evade, return to normal pattern in every Metal Gear game since. My problem is how short the alert phases last for. Get discovered and run off and successfully find a hiding place immediately, and you're looking at about 10 to 15 seconds of an alert phase before the enemies just shrug their shoulders and continue life as normal. Now look, obviously they can't look for you forever. That would make the game unplayable. But in later games, they improved upon this in a way that can only be described as genius. They made the phase longer. That's it. In other words, the game upped the punishment for careless gameplay, making the player more naturally cautious and making it feel more like, you know, an actual stealth game. I understand that looking at this in hindsight, it's easy to criticize it. But after playing subsequent entries in the series, it's gallingly obvious how short these phases are, and how easily fixable it could have been. On a similar note, the guards in later games were also not all legally blind, so that was an improvement too. Luckily, this doesn't ruin the experience, otherwise I'd stop the video right here. But it is something that you kinda wish they'd remedied at the time. I just mentioned how I didn't want to spoil a particular part of the game. Something that's common in the videos I make, as I'm aware that not everyone will have played these games. That said, in reviewing the rest of this particular game, some spoilers are going to be inevitable. Metal Gear Solid isn't just a very story-driven experience. It's a game that is punctuated by boss fights, which segment the game and are critical in moving the story forward. I'm going to keep it as light on the spoiler front here as I possibly can, and I'll avoid revealing any major twists. But still, this is a heads up for those of you who've never played it. There will be some spoilers. Sneaking past the guards and a surveillance camera, and you make your way towards a vent you crawl through to get into the base's interior. Just one of many elements borrowed from Metal Gear 2, by the way. While crawling, you get a call from the Colonel introducing a new member of their team, Master Miller, another holdover from MG2, who aided Snake in that game. He gives Snake combat and survival advice when called. With Miller now introduced, we are pretty much round off the supporting cast of radio support for the rest of the game. They're well voiced and for the most part complement Snake's personality very well. When you make your way into the first base, you're now expected to engage with the game's fundamental mechanics without having your hand held, so the adventure is now well and truly underway. With the game's pulsing musical undercurrent, drenched in that signature echo, soundtracking the action as Snake strategically maneuvers past enemies while searching for the DARPA chief, we are fully immersed in the game's atmosphere. Upon making our way to a lower floor, we come across the chief in a prison cell, with another woman in the cell next to him. And upon entering his cell via another vent, we're presented with three of the game's most important and prominent features: long cutscenes, winding, twisting storytelling, and in-game cinematic set pieces. When Snake informs Anderson of who he is and his intent to save him, Anderson begins telling Snake about a new Metal Gear prototype known as Metal Gear Rex, which is being housed on Shadow Moses, and how a special security key is needed to operate it. For the completely uninitiated, a Metal Gear is a bipedal tank which has taken many forms throughout the series. They are highly mobile and can fire a wide array of weaponry, including nuclear weapons. One of many minor spoilers, while telling Snake this information and asking Snake if he knew how to use the key, the DARPA chief suddenly dies of a heart attack. Escaping the cage, Snake sees the naked, tied up body of a soldier and is then confronted by Merrill, who neutralized the soldier and is now pointing a gun at him, accusing him of killing the chief. Seeing her tentativeness, Snake undermines her threats, and as numerous guards come in to apprehend or kill them both, is ordered by Snake to open fire. This encounter acts as the first major set piece in the game, one of a handful of sub-bosses between the player and the game's soldiers. It plays out simply enough with Snake and Merrill simply shooting a revolving door of soldiers who arrive in groups of three and occasionally toss grenades through the door. Post-fight, Merrill runs off, and as Snake watches her, or a part of her, fleeing, she suddenly turns around and starts firing at him. Just then, we're treated to a flashback sequence showing Liquid standing with two unknown men over a dead body, talking about how they accidentally killed this person and now they're never going to get the detonation codes they need for Metal Gear. All of a sudden, we're transported back to the hallway as an apparition of an unknown man in a bodysuit and a gas mask appears, whispering underneath his mask, "Good girl, just like that," before disappearing as Merrill boards an elevator, ending the whole encounter. The two cutscenes here, including the codec calls in between, take about 10 minutes. Again, for those of us who have played other games in the series, a 10-minute cutscene isn't that lengthy. But for the time, and for those unfamiliar with the series, 10 minutes of completely uninteractive game time can seem a bit extravagant, even wasteful. However, long cutscenes and codec conversations, a great many far longer than this, are a cornerstone of the game and the series as a whole, and is one of those things that you either love or hate. Again, given Kojima's admiration for the film genre and his desire to craft complex narratives, the inclusion of these kinds of cinematic detours should come as no surprise. And for those of us who are gluttons for this kind of bloated storytelling, moments like this are extremely gratifying and give us an incentive to keep playing to see what happens next. Speaking of complex narratives, it's in this cutscene that we get our first taste of Kojima's writing style. Anderson's heart attack right in the middle of talking to Snake seems a little fishy, and this is a feeling that Kojima and his team want to drum into the player as much as possible. Snake immediately casts aspersions on the Colonel, who does little to conceal his shadiness by openly admitting he doesn't have all the information about the mission. This sets up one of the most prominent narrative threads that is ever present in MGS: conspiracy. We're less than an hour and only one set piece in, and already Snake, and the player by proxy, feels like he can trust no one. The last moment of this scene, where the mysterious floating man appears, a man who Naomi confirms directly is Psycho Mantis, Foxhound's psychic who uses telekinetic abilities to control people's minds, introduces another element of MGS: the supernatural. Whether spiritual or physical, many of the game's antagonists possess supernatural abilities, or at least skills so sharply defined that they push the boundaries of human possibility. This may seem at odds with the game's military aesthetic when explained so bluntly in a YouTube video, but it's just one of those things that you really have to play and experience to understand. It doesn't necessarily make sense on paper, but when you're physically playing through it, you realize it's just another facet that contributes to the strong Metal Gear atmosphere, which just feels right in practice. Speaking of feeling right in practice, this leads us to the third feature of Metal Gear Solid found in this encounter: cinematic set pieces. Metal Gear Solid is one of those games that's bigger and better than the sum of its parts. Due to the limited hardware and software of the time, action games had to be clever and strategic in how they presented some of their bigger ideas so that they could be executed without feeling underwhelming. Metal Gear Solid does this masterfully through the use of epic music, tension built in cutscenes, and the shrewd use of level design and gameplay mechanics. MGS is a third-person shooter at its core, with a healthy dose of hand-to-hand striking and strangling thrown in for good measure. However, the game also uses a dynamic fixed camera angle, meaning that the only control Snake has over his weapons, sniper rifles and launchers notwithstanding, is to fire them in the general direction of the enemy. Having the guards come into a relatively small room and three at a time skirts around this limitation shrewdly, as the confined space and number of guards means that the player's natural instinct, limited camera or not, will be to just open fire on the threat and spray them with as many bullets as possible. The fact that you're doing this with someone you just met who came close to blowing your head off amidst all of this only adds to the urgency. Again, Kojima is a clever boy, and his team are some clever lads, and it's a testament to them that moments like this are still playable 23 years later. And, to borrow from the opening song title, the best is yet to come. Aside from the little dose of blue humour that takes the form of a naked soldier, a soldier we would see more of as the game and series progresses, alongside Kojima's taste of sophomoric toilet humour which we, again, would see more of. The other important thing we literally obtain from this encounter is a card key. Given to us by the DARPA chief, his level 1 key gives us access to all doors with the number 1 written on them. This is not just a one-off gimmick, however. These cards are obtained after significant moments in the game, and are used to access new areas, many of which must be accessed in order to progress the story. These cards, therefore, are used as the game's progression yardstick, with new encounters giving you higher numbers of keys, which can get you access into higher level doors. It also gives the game the illusion of being less linear than it actually is, as earlier areas in the game have higher level doors that cannot be entered until you've beaten a significant chunk of the game. This also leads to a not so insignificant amount of backtracking, an issue we will address a little later in the video. So, with the first major encounter under our belt, a new card key in our inventory, and many of the game's elements and quirks familiar to us, this is where the game really finds its stride. So now that the mechanics and aesthetics are established, the game must continue to keep challenging the player in order to keep them interested. The key cards are, well, a key factor in this also. See, the cards just don't unlock specific areas that help you navigate Shadow Moses Island. They also give you access, in an incremental fashion, to new weapons. In the floor directly below the holding cell, there is an armory with 9 different rooms which contain different weapons which require different level cards to access. You will have to visit this floor on a few different occasions to obtain weaponry to fight specific enemies or get past certain situations. It's old school gaming progression, but again, it's done in a way that feels apt in context. A good example of this is our first true boss fight, which happened shortly after the DARPA chief debacle. Snake must obtain C4 explosives to blow holes in the walls of the armory that have been newly painted over to gain access to the Arms Tech president, Kenneth Baker. You find the C4 in one of the rooms and, blowing up the parts of the wall that are somewhat discolored, hopefully without drawing attention to yourself, you finally find the right path to Baker. I also just want to stop here a moment and say that, for the time, having to find the off-color patches of the wall and blowing them up to reveal new rooms was pretty elaborate and a little ingenious. Anyway, when you find Baker, he's strapped to a pillar in a small room, but stops Snake from freeing him when he draws attention to the wires surrounding him, which are rigged to explode. Suddenly, a man in a trench coat playing with his revolver walks in. His name is Revolver Ocelot, a name only too familiar with fans of the series, but for the uninitiated, all you need to know is that he's Liquid Snake's right-hand man, and an integral part of the terrorist plot. Ocelot brags about how awesome his weapon is before a fight ensues between himself and the player. The first boss fight in the game is decent, if a little one-dimensional, and while there will be better ones as the game progresses, it really shows the developer's ability to work around the limited camera and third-person combat. Basically, you chase Ocelot around the pillar in circles shooting at him. However, his bullets can ricochet off the walls so he can hit you from anywhere. Your best bet is to either change direction and cut him off mid-flight, or wait until he stops to reload, and put a few bullets in him. Try to fire past Baker to get a cheap shot off, and you run the risk of blowing Baker up. Quick tangent. Doing this doesn't just bring up the game's game over screen, as you'll actually be chastised by Ocelot too for making such a foolish mistake. It's another one of those typically Kojima-ish moments of fourth wall breaking humour. Another spoiler here. The boss fight ends when you chip away at most of Ocelot's health. However, rather than killing him, a cutscene is triggered with an invigorated ocelot, claiming that he's only warming up, before a cyborg ninja comes out of nowhere and chops off his hand. The ninja walks towards Snake, and when asked by your hero to identify himself, he responds by saying, "I'm like you, I have no name," before going completely berserk and running out of the room. Snake then talks to Baker, who is an unscrupulous warmonger but has something of a sense of humour about the whole situation. He tells Snake that Metal Gear Rex has the ability to launch nuclear warheads, and that there are stacks of nuclear waste just laying on the island. He also gives us a mini lecture on the US war economy. He then gives Snake a level 2 key, and tells him to find Meryl, as apparently she knows the secret to using the PAL key to launch Metal Gear. Suddenly, like Anderson, Baker gets a heart attack and dies. Q and irate Snake having a chat with the Colonel, who, it is also revealed, is Meryl's uncle, and the rest of his team who don't ingratiate themselves to Snake by claiming they have no idea why the second man he has been sent to rescue has died in the exact same way. Suddenly, everything is kicked up a notch, while the story is still being propelled forward. The key card in question gives Snake access to the back door leading out of the warehouse, which unlocks the next area of the game. It also gives Snake access to more of the armory rooms. The intrigue has been ramped up by introducing a new antagonist in Ocelot, an ally in Meryl, and a wild card in the form of this mysterious ninja. The coincidental second death of Baker and all the crazy shit that's going on adds to the feeling of uncertainty and curiosity in the player also, and the general distrust of those around Snake, who, as a character, is a generally distrusting individual at the best of times. Truthfully, it's hard to know if this kind of story would have been as impactful in a movie or a series as it is in a video game. When I say it out loud, it all sounds a little pedestrian. I guess you just need to take me at my word when I tell you that in the context of the game itself, it works and is actually very engrossing. Maybe it's because it's an interactive medium. In video games, and this is one of the reasons why I feel story is often criminally overlooked, you have the luxury of introducing complex narratives or multiple different ones as you get to flesh them out over the hours and hours of playtime. Players spend a lot of time in video games doing things which have nothing to do with story. This allows them a break from cutscenes while also allowing certain plot points to simmer in their minds before hitting them over the head with more information. Video games aren't saddled with the same constraints as television and cinema in terms of time, and oftentimes players complain about the shortness of games rather than how long they are, meaning that if you can stomach their long cutscenes, it allows more room for plot, twists, turns, and mystery. Also, the story gets much more complicated, much juicier, and much wackier as it goes. And while there won't be any major spoilers here, suffice it to say, shit gets real crazy in the final quarter. However, in the meantime, let's jump back to the post-Ocelot section of the game. The second quarter of the game is about two things primarily, which we haven't touched on in great detail yet: character development and boss battles. It will be incorrect to say that Metal Gear Solid reaches its narrative peak during this portion of the game, because it doesn't. However, in my opinion, I think many of the characters' arcs do. Starting with the big kahuna first. Snake is initially positioned as a stoic, flirtatious secret agent who's cool under pressure and quick with a sly remark. Typical James Bond, John McClane stuff. However, we see Snake run the gambit of emotions by the time we reach the end of the game's second quarter. And after he's been subjected to, spoiler warning, a rigorous set of torture sessions at the hands, or actually hand, of Ocelot, which, pending his escape, is right where the second quarter ends and the third begins. He goes from the aforementioned cool tough guy, to distrusting and angry during the DARPA and arms tech sections, to smitten with Meryl, to vulnerable and somewhat desperate while laying in a prison cell. This moment in particular is when I think Snake's character shines brightest. Moments like promising the Colonel that he's going to protect Meryl, irrespective of what the two have been through personally, or asking a reluctant Naomi to tell him about herself to distract him from the physical pain he's in, are affecting and insightful, and show off the quality of the writing as well as the performances from the voice actors. It may not be Oscar-worthy stuff necessarily, but given the likability of the characters, and the fact that as players we've been with Snake every step of the way, all of these emotions hit us that bit harder. In MGS, there are three major allies to Snake. Merrill, the Colonel, and Dr. Hal Otacon Emmerich. Snake first meets Otacon while he's hiding in a locker from Cyborg Ninja. The fight with the ninja is one of the best bosses in the game. Armed with a sword and possessing superhuman strength and the ability to teleport, Snake finds it almost impossible to hit him with his arsenal of weapons. Exhausting all options, the player will eventually holster his gun and just try to punch him in the face. Upon landing a left-right roundhouse combination, the ninja will discard his sword, laud Snake for using his hands, claiming that hand-to-hand fighting is the basis of all combat, and now the fight is really on. Given the severity of his blows and his ability to quickly teleport from one location to the other, the player is encouraged to plan striking attacks strategically rather than brawl with the ninja. The ninja's patterns of attack can be telegraphed after seeing or being struck by them a few times, but he mixes it up as the encounter progresses by interrupting his own attacks and increasing the frequency of his teleportations. Here are three things that make this encounter so good. The first is the emphasis that it puts on the melee attacks. In reality, there are only three forms of attack Snake can utilize in the game unarmed: the aforementioned kickboxing combination, a rear naked choke, and a judo throw. In the ninja fight, you're basically limited to just using the combination, but all the gaga around the fight distracts you from the fact that you're basically throwing the same combo over and over again, because you're just happy to land anything at all without getting hit back, especially if you're playing the game on the harder difficulty settings. The second thing is the fight's progression. As you chip away at the ninja's health bar, he'll begin to alter his methods of attack. Not just by mixing up the rhythm as we've just discussed, but he'll also camouflage himself and, near the end, surround himself with a pulsating electronic force field, meaning that the player must constantly reassess their own plan of attack and switch up the timing of said attacks to match the ninja's movements and defenses. This kind of progression is lacking in the three other encounters that you would have engaged in up to this point. The fight with enemy soldiers alongside Merrill basically only requires you to fire at enemies until they stop coming. And the Ocelot fight, while requiring some skill and timing, never evolves beyond a run and gun encounter once you've somewhat figured out a rhythm to cut off his attack. The third encounter, which we didn't discuss, takes place between Snake and a tank driven by another member of Foxhound, Vulcan Raven. It's a pretty straightforward encounter, which involves Snake lobbing grenades at the tank while avoiding returning fire. Unlike these encounters, however, the ninja fight constantly evolves the longer it goes on, keeping the player guessing while ratcheting up the tension, and all without ever necessarily firing a gun. The third thing I like about the fight is the story that's being told as it goes on. Not only does the ninja change up his plan of attack, but he also talks to Snake throughout, fawning over the joy and honor of battle. As he gets weaker, his mental state starts to deteriorate, and we see him having something of a mental breakdown. The information gathered upon completing the fight is the first proper little twist in the game, so I'm not going to divulge it here, but it makes for a hell of a cutscene and a codec conversation afterwards. After fighting the ninja, we are formally introduced to Otacon, soaked in his own urine and cowering for his life in a locker. The first encounter is less than ideal, as Snake has little patience for the good doctor's meekness. Hal has been working on Metal Gear as a chief scientist, but was unaware of its nuclear launch capabilities. He also fills Snake in on his family's history as scientists and their contributions to creating weapons of mass destruction. He also tells Snake that he's seen Merrill disguised as an enemy soldier, but that her walk, the same walk that Snake was distracted by, gives her away. It's a lot of information to take in at once, but again, if given over a long period of time during cutscenes, it doesn't feel overwhelming. Especially considering the fact that at this point as a player, you're all in and want to soak up as much of the information about Ocelot, Metal Gear, and everything else as you possibly can. At least if you're like me. Otacon's demeanor, that of a pathetic, sniveling geek, is by design also, as the player's attitude towards him will soften as the game progresses. Snake's attitude towards him softens also, and, much like with Merrill, Otacon brings out a more tender side of Snake. Otacon's information eventually leads you to Merrill, and an awkward encounter in a ladies' washroom. This conversation between Snake and Merrill highlights some of the weaker moments in the story. The themes of the conversation by themselves are fine and could be contextually relevant. The morality of war, the psychological disposition of the soldier, love and identity. However, when they're shoved into one cutscene like this, it comes across as scattered. The love angle between Snake and Meryl is one of the few big narrative missteps in Metal Gear Solid. The idea itself isn't bad, it's just pushed way too early and way too quickly. In a game that's dominated by cutscenes and story, Kojima easily could have let this idea simmer and build towards a more gratifying payoff. Instead, the game blows its load early, and we're basically supposed to believe that these two characters just love each other now. Again, the concept isn't bad, and as the game progresses, it starts to feel more natural, if a little mushy. It was just too much too soon. What isn't too much too soon is the next fight. Making your way to the commander room with Meryl, you come into contact with Psycho Mantis, the man who appeared like an apparition earlier in the game. It is revealed that Mantis was controlling Meryl's mind, and while reading her mind, he basically forces her to confess her love for Snake, as if we didn't already kind of know. He also makes her draw her pistol on Snake. After a panic-coded conversation with the Colonel, Snake realizes that his only recourse is to lay the smackdown on her and knock her ass out. After a couple of Francis and Ganu-like rights and lefts that put Meryl out for the count, the boss fight can really begin. And this is arguably the best boss fight in the entire game, due primarily to its creativity and ingenuity. At the very beginning, we're treated to a cutscene where Mantis claims he can read your mind. He does this by making comments on your playstyle up till this point. If you ran through the game recklessly, falling into traps and forgoing stealth by just opening fire on enemies, Mantis will comment on your recklessness and lack of intelligence. If you were stealthy, didn't kill too many people, and avoided alerting soldiers to your position, Mantis will proclaim you cautious and a coward. If you had other Konami games saved on your memory card, he would call them out by name. If you didn't, he'd simply say your memory was completely clean. Then he tells you he can move your controller just by the power of his mind. And a couple of telekinetic hand gestures later, the vibration on your DualShock controller will be triggered. How this all works mechanically is pretty straightforward, but there's just no denying the creativity and sheer cheekiness on display here. It's one of those signature Kojima moments that made every Metal Gear game he ever touched so special. The fight itself plays heavily on the theme of the supernatural that underpins much of the game. Mantis uses his mind to launch objects at you, things like chairs, paintings, and vases. Snake must dodge these flying projectiles and return fire on Mantis, wearing down his health bar. Much like the ninja fight, the relative simplicity of the exchange is masked by all the bells and whistles around it, such as the music that plays in the background and the thermal goggles that you will probably equip to make the encounter easier. There are also some cool, weird moments, like how Mantis will change the screen to black with a generic channel number, leading players who would have played this on an old television set back in the day to think, for a split second, that their console had become disconnected with their television. Mantis will also revive Meryl and have her point a gun at her head, giving Snake only a few seconds to Tyson her again to prevent her from killing herself. There may be frantic calls to Colonel also, with Snake asking how to beat this guy, because, like Ninja, it's almost impossible to hit him with gunfire. Minor spoiler here, the easiest way to beat Mantis is to switch the controller from player 1 to player 2, which limits Mantis' ability to read the player's mind. The Mantis fight is similar to the Ninja one in that it subverts the player's expectations as to what the most logical plan of attack is. Unlike the Ninja fight, however, it really ramps up the fourth wall breaking antics. And I think this is why it's held in such high regard by fans of the series. The controller switching and screen blackening are so uniquely Metal Gear, and back then there was really no other game that toyed with the hardware or the player in this way. The Mantis fight also has a revelatory ending, but unlike the Ninja one, which ends on something of a cliffhanger, there is a finality to the Mantis one. What I like about Mantis' character is his brutal honesty. He's not entirely good or entirely evil. He's a scarred individual whose evil deeds were at least in part due to his upbringing. He's unapologetic, and while he's mostly bad, he shows glimpses of empathy which help humanize him. The ending of the Mantis encounter is one of those really good, thorough character closures in the game, and is one of the storyline high marks that Kojima should be applauded for. The third boss fight occurs almost immediately after this one. With Meryl's mind once again her own, they continue to make their way towards the underground base where Rex is being held. After a walk and a crawl through a snowy cavern, which sees you trying not to get bitten to death by wolves, while Meryl, assumingly due to her feminine touch and charm, is able to go through with the love and affection of these wild animals, you make your way through a door into a long corridor. As I said at the beginning of the video, it's very difficult to review this game thoroughly without spoiling much of it. And this next one is one of the last but biggest ones I'm going to reveal. So again, skip ahead a few minutes if you want to play this game at some point and preserve its bigger moments. When you enter the corridor, Meryl is shot by an unknown sniper. Taking cover behind a wall, Snake is unable to retrieve Meryl, as he will be picked off if he attempts to do it. There is a short cutscene where Meryl tells Snake to save himself, to go on living and not to give up on people. This is a great scene that is pretty well acted. The performances of Debbie Mae West, who voices Meryl, are honestly some of the most wooden in the entire game. But here you can really feel the desperation and sadness in her voice, while Hader's performance is as great as always. Moreover, while the previous conversations about love felt premature and forced, this one feels timely and right. Gamers aren't idiots, at least for the most part. And I feel like the sexual tension and bond between both characters was inferred strongly enough at the beginning of the game without them overtly referencing it. And with Meryl laying there not sure if she's going to live or die, I just wish they toned it down leading up to this and had saved their deep exchanges about love and life for this moment. The codec conversation between Snake and the Colonel is equally as good. The Colonel, as a military man, must advise Snake not to run out and rescue Meryl, even if it puts the life of his niece in jeopardy. They both know that Snake cannot fight the sniper without a rifle of his own either, and Naomi informs Snake that the person shooting at him is Foxhound Sniper Wolf, a skilled assassin who can wait for days or weeks on a target in one sniper's position and operates without a spotter. So with all this new information, Snake must set out to find a sniper rifle, and this is where one of the game's biggest flaws comes into play. Remember that armory at the beginning of the game where you demolished all those walls? Well, guess where the rifle is? This is Metal Gear Solid's first dive into the noble art of backtracking, and unfortunately, will not be its last. As you rush back to what is essentially the beginning of the game, you start to realize that in actuality, it's not that much ground to cover. Now, you would think that this is a good thing because it saves time, but it has an unintended consequence. As I've said before, Metal Gear Solid is a master of camouflage, no pun intended. It hides its weaknesses and its limitations of the PS1's hardware expertly, like a shadow puppeteer broadcasting monster's shadows on the wall. By showing the player that they can run back to the start of the map in a matter of minutes, you're allowing them to peek behind the curtain of the game's level design, and it takes away a little from the feeling of conquest and accomplishment. The game tries to soften the blow by planting a few claymores and extra cameras in the snowy trenches where the Raven tank battle took place, but it just comes across as an attempt to lengthen and harden the backtracking experience, which, in all honesty, it doesn't even really achieve at doing. When we make it back to the corridor, Meryl has been taken away, but we don't have time to think about that because we have a fight on our hands. The fight with Sniper Wolf is a mixed bag. The concept is good, and using the sniper rifle makes for an intriguing change of pace from the one-dimensional third-person combat, putting you in a first-person perspective and giving you manual control over the rifle. Our target is positioned on a stairwell a floor above us, giving her a better vantage point. She also has the ability to fire her rifle from a standing, kneeling, and prone position, whereas Snake can only fire it while prone. She's also better at using the weapon than Snake, able to find her target and fire relatively quickly and with a steady hand. Whereas it takes Snake a few seconds to line up the shot, and his hands will start shaking violently if he doesn't take a diazepam muscle relaxer every 30 seconds or so. All of this is fine, and obviously you want your foe to be more powerful than you, especially if it's in regards to a specific niche like sniping. The major issue with the boss is that sniping highlights some minor mechanical deficiencies in the game. Snake can only fire from a prone position, which would be fine if it wasn't for the fact that Snake only has small vertical walls for cover. Snake's movements while prone is also limited. He can only change direction in 90 degree increments, so basically you can move four ways relative to your starting position. Also, when you're hit by Wolf, it throws your position completely out of whack, forcing you to reset. I like the fact that the boss is challenging, and I realise that Snake's limited movements is most likely down to the limitations of the hardware. I also like the fact that they had the balls to put in a sniping boss fight too. It's just that this encounter feels a little choppy, and doesn't quite hold up to the ones that precede it. Even still, the game would give us another sniping battle later on, which, you'll be glad to know, is much better, due in large part to the environment in which it takes place. After the encounter, you make your way down the long corridor towards the door when suddenly, minor spoiler alert, you're confronted by Wolf and a gang of soldiers who hold you up. This sets up the entire torture scene which I referenced earlier on. I'm not going to spend too much time talking about it here, as it's very plot heavy, but needless to say, it's a tense encounter with a lot riding on the line. It's also one of those iconic moments that Metal Gear fans love. After escaping the torture chamber because, well, of course you do, you make your way back to the corridor. Unfortunately, the torture chamber is on the same floor in the same building where the DARPA chief has his heart attack, so you're essentially forced to make your way through the entire map up until the corridor for the third time. But at least this is the last bit of backtracking in the game. Well, for a while. When you finally make your way back to the door at the end of the corridor, we're officially into the third quarter of the game. And this quarter is all about action and set pieces. One thing I will say for Metal Gear Solid is that, backtracking aside, the game is paced beautifully. The only thing I love more than a good story in a game is a good bit of pacing, and Metal Gear Solid paces its story extremely well overall. Well-paced story-driven games understand that you cannot throw everything at the player at once. You have to give them new weapons, items, challenges, and gameplay elements incrementally, all while managing to keep them engaged. Up until this point, Metal Gear's MO was mostly stealth-based. Evasion was the safest and most logical course of action to navigate the environment. However, the first thing that happens when you make your way through the door is a camera spots you. This triggers a seemingly endless swarm of enemy soldiers to come after you. With a staircase your only means of escape, you start to climb, and oh boy do I mean climb, which triggers another sub-boss encounter involving the enemy soldiers. Snake makes his way up what feels like a never-ending staircase, firing his FAMAS rifle at enemies following on his heels, as well as enemies climbing down, trying to cut him off. Picking up ammo and health rations as you go between hectic gunfire, it is by far the most Hollywood-esque moment in the game thus far, and once again a testament to the clever level design and overall presentation of MGS. While mechanically, you're just doing the same thing for 5 minutes, the brilliant musical score, winding camera angle, and that desperate scramble to find more ammo and rations to stay alive make it so much fun to play through. Again, it's those bells and whistles that are distracting you from the fundamentally basic nature of the gameplay. By the time you've disposed of all the enemies and reached the platform at the top of the stairs, you're able to take a deep breath and bask in the achievement and relief of completing the encounter. It's one of those moments that really makes you feel like you're in a movie, and it actually gets better from here. When you reach the rooftop, you're suddenly confronted by Liquid manning a Hind D helicopter. He starts shooting at you, which forces you to rappel down the side of the building to safety. This rappel sequence only occurs once in the game, but it works really well, throwing totally new mechanics at you as you jump and strafe to avoid Liquid's gunfire. It's moments like this that remind me just how damn playable Metal Gear Solid is even today. A few limitations aside, it makes such good use of the hardware and software, which again is a testament to the work of Konami. You can only imagine how amazing this felt for those who played it upon release. All of this eventually leads Snake to a showdown with Liquid on the rooftop of another building. When people talk about great bosses in Metal Gear Solid, this one often gets overlooked. But in my opinion, it's one of the best in the game. The setup is pretty basic. When Snake reaches the rooftop, he is once again confronted by Liquid Snake in the Hind D. This time, however, it's clear that they're going to fight, and the two of them have a little chat before they attempt to massacre one another. Liquid calls Snake brother and tells him he's going to send Snake to hell to meet his father, Big Boss. Snake is completely taken aback by this and has no idea what he's talking about. However, this is foreshadowed throughout the game, with people commenting on how similar Solid and Liquid look. This is one of those funny things that can only happen in a fifth generation game. Because their faces are so blurry, it's difficult to tell just by looking at their models that they're supposed to be twins. That being said, given that Snake exists in this world, it's kind of hilarious that he doesn't recognize his own face. Even still, it's just a minor detail, and the player is now ready for a showdown with the enigmatic main antagonist. The battle itself is a blast and requires Snake to make use of a new toy, the Stinger missile, a homing device that allows you to fire a powerful missile by tracking the target, in this case a helicopter. Whereas the sniper rifle can be cumbersome at times to use, the Stinger, which too can only be used in first person, can be fired from standing and can also be moved in any direction fluidly, making it easier and more fun to use. You have to time your shots at the helicopter in order to successfully hit it, and the Hind, naturally, has far superior firepower and can rain down on you with automatic helicopter bullets as well as missile strikes. With only a ventilation system in the middle of the rooftop as cover, you have to pop in and out and strike when the helicopter is flying and unable to return fire. Running out of ammo and rations, particularly on the higher difficulties, is part of the challenge also. You have to run out into the open to restock on both. Liquid mixes up the attacks by launching kamikaze-like bomb strikes and flying underneath the building before popping back up with a hail of bullets to keep you guessing. The overall vibe is part of what makes this encounter so good too. I'm not going to harp about the music again, as critical as it is to the entire game, but this encounter is really all about the visual presentation. The shots of Snake and Liquid battling it out on the rooftop at night, with snow pelting down, is one of the most impressive scenes in the game, while the ending, which sees Snake down the helicopter with one last Stinger hit, is one of the most iconic visuals. I didn't say spoiler here because, fuck it, he's the main bad guy, of course he's not going to die here. Spoiler or no spoiler, I'm going to take a quick detour here to talk about the Foxhound unit. The Metal Gear franchise has been responsible for some of the best boss fights in gaming history, and that tradition really began here. While in my humble opinion, I think the best bosses in the entire series from a pure gameplay perspective can be found in Metal Gear Solid 3, a game I'm sure I'll be covering in the future. The best bosses from a character perspective are in this game, hands down. Liquid is a generic bad guy on the surface, but the more you're exposed to him and the more you learn about him, the more the depths of his character and his psyche are revealed, showing you a complexity that belies his exterior. Revolver Ocelot, who would go on to become one of the most iconic characters in the series, is one of the cooler antagonists. The cold, callous, yet conversational tone he adopts while talking to Snake between torture sessions is a testament to this, and makes him instantly memorable. Sniper Wolf, who we'll see more of later, is a ruthless yet seductive femme fatale whose personality, much like Mantis, was groomed by her upbringing. Vulcan Raven, who we will take a closer look at momentarily, is a warrior who takes honor in battle and who possesses an almost sage-like quality. These characters, along with Mantis, are by far the most fleshed out, iconic, and frankly likable set of bosses in the entire series. Their stories and personalities are given room to grow in the fertile narrative ground of MGS, and thus have a depth to them that other factions in later games frankly lack. And, considering that, even though they're the second best set of bosses in the series from a pure gameplay perspective, they're probably the most well-rounded group overall. There is one more boss fight before we reach the final quarter of the game, and that is, minor spoiler, a second showdown between Snake and Sniper Wolf. A better encounter in every conceivable way than their first one. The setting is better, the build-up is better, and the level design is far more conducive to a sniping battle than the narrower hallways of their first fight. At this point, Wolf, who becomes infatuated by her targets before killing them, is now brimming with an almost sexual tension at the thought of killing Snake. Only problem is Otacon has come down with a serious case of Stockholm Syndrome, and pleads with both parties not to fire bullets into each other. They ignore him and proceed to do just that. The other factor is Meryl. Wolf was the one who shot her, and given that her status is still unknown, Snake has a strong animus towards her heading into the battle. As I said, the level design here is much more suitable for a sniping duel. Taking place in a big snowy field, it allows for horizontal movements and permits both Snake and Wolf to seek cover and try to get the jump on one another. Not only does it make the fight feel more dynamic, but it hides the limitations of using the sniper rifle much more effectively, as Snake feels less hamstrung, having more places to lay down and fire. You do have the option to cheat the boss by using the Nikita missile, a weapon that fires missiles that can automatically be controlled after they've been launched, a weapon you use to destroy an electrical field earlier in the game. But if you've never played the game before, I recommend doing it the honest way first, so you can experience it as intended. After beating Wolf, we get another Psycho Mantis-esque back and forth between Snake and Wolf. Out of all the ones in the game, this may be the best, and is certainly the most emotional. Wolf tells Snake her backstory and explains to him why she joined up with Foxhound, and actually comes across as a pretty sympathetic character. The appearance of Otacon lamenting the violence that just took place, and pleading with Snake to tell him what it's all for, is just the cherry on top. I should also note that there is a scene just prior to the Hind D battle, where Snake and Otacon have a discussion about whether or not love can bloom on the battlefield. Much like Snake's initial talk with Meryl, I found this moment a little premature, from a story and pacing perspective, and I feel like the payoff here, after such an emotional experience for all three parties, is much more suitable and effective. I know it may sound like I'm nitpicking the story here, and I think part of the reason is because I've played this game so many times over the years, and in revisiting it, I'm probably looking at it through a more critical lens. But make no mistake about it, the Metal Gear series is my favourite franchise of all time, and this game is among my favourites in the franchise. And a few flaws aside, the story is absolutely tremendous, and it only gets better as the game draws closer to the end. Which brings us beautifully to the final quarter of the game, a quarter which is, fittingly, all about story and resolution. Aside from detailing some elements of the remaining boss battles, I'm going to talk very cryptically about the rest of the story from here on out. The time for minor spoilers is over, and every major twist and revelation occurs during the game's closing moments. From a gameplay perspective, your interaction with the guards is still business as usual. Stealth is still the best option, and enemies are better off dispatched with chokeholds or silenced weapons if necessary. The game reinforces this by introducing some more claustrophobic and dangerous level design with fewer places to hide, such as the foundry at the beginning of this section. This reinforces the idea of stealth as the primary modus operandi by increasing the risk involved in engaging in open firefights. Even still, the challenge remains more or less the same, and players will probably approach them the way they did throughout the game. With that said, there is far less emphasis on action in this section overall. Between those areas like the foundry, which are populated by guards, there are big open areas with massive elevators scaling many floors that must be ridden to gain access to the hold where Metal Gear is. These are designed with one purpose in mind: story. During these long elevator rides, you will receive a bunch of lengthy codec calls from the Colonel, Naomi, and others. In these conversations, mysteries are revealed, loose ends are tied up, and new unexpected twists are thrown at the player. For those of us who love the Metal Gear style of complex, drawn-out storytelling, these moments are really enjoyable. As a player, I love that the writers took so much time to craft this kind of story and support it with this much dialogue. And I love that the developers had the balls to dedicate so much of the game to explaining the plot. And I didn't feel any pressure to cut out these lengthy moments of story exploration. It really adds to the drama and makes it feel like more than just a mindless action game. There is also another backtracking section, which occurs later on, which, unlike the previous ones, serves a more tangible purpose and is also used as an excuse to expand upon the plot even more. It was definitely designed to lengthen the game even more also, but at least this time, it doesn't really feel like that in execution. The last boss before the real final showdown occurs when, last minor spoiler, you have to face Vulcan Raven for a second time. Much like the whole Sniper Wolf saga, this second encounter is by far better than the first. However, in this instance, the second fight is completely different. The first one, as I briefly mentioned, took place on a field with Snake lobbing grenades at Raven's tank. There was nothing fundamentally wrong with it, it was just a bit one note. This one, however, takes place in a freezing warehouse and sees Raven on foot, armed with an M61 Vulcan cannon, a sort of giant minigun, chasing Snake around and shooting at him. For such a large man wielding such a large weapon, Raven is surprisingly quick. He also has a large field of vision, something the soldiers should have had to begin with. Doomed in a straight-up firefight, the one thing that Snake has going for him are the stacks of crates which populate the map. Snake can use these to hide from Raven, but he can also use them to plant ambushes. One of the best things about this encounter are the different strategies you can use to attack Raven. You can plant claymores, sneak up behind him with your FAMAS and open fire, or wait around the corner with your Stinger missile, among others. Much like the ninja fight, once you start to chip away at Raven's health, he'll vary up his plan of attack, making him more difficult to hit. He actually starts to speed up, and he doesn't have a set route that he walks between the crates, making his movements harder to intercept. He also destroys and topples the crates the more he shoots at them, eliminating cover spots and creating barriers between walkways, limiting Snake's ability to hide and cutting off previously viable avenues of escape. When defeated, Raven and Snake have that now obligatory heart-to-heart. I mentioned earlier that Raven is a warrior and a spiritual man, and that really comes across here. He delves into Snake's ancestry and comments on his soul and his spirit, reaffirming what Mantis had told him. He is a warrior, yes, but also a killer and a savage. There isn't much else I can cover in the final portion of the game without completely ruining it, so I'll just give a couple of bullet points before wrapping things up. The rest of the final quarter is the most plot-heavy portion of the game, and just when you thought you'd been hit with the game's big major plot twist, there's yet another one just around the corner. The pacing here is the slowest in the game, which isn't necessarily a bad thing because as players, we need time to allow for the plot to develop and settle without being bombarded with action or more story. There are also sporadic moments of tense combat, like the Raven fight, that prevent the game from feeling completely like an interactive movie. Naturally, you do finally get to see Metal Gear Rex, and yes, it is epic. The team once again shows its ingenuity with how Snake interacts with it, skirting around those hardware limitations in clever and unique ways. When we finally get to that last encounter, the payoff from both a gameplay and storyline perspective is very satisfying. I'm not going to say that it's the best boss in the game, because it isn't. In fact, it probably wouldn't crack the top 5. But it is appropriately bombastic for the finale of a game like Metal Gear Solid. At this point too, the game also throws a lot of new plot points at you, ones that couldn't have been revealed at any other point in the game. Again, it's heavy, and can be a lot for players who just want to shoot at things and blow shit up. But this is the Metal Gear charm. It's deep, conspiratorial, convoluted, and a little wacky. But it's brilliant for all those reasons. So in the end, what is Metal Gear Solid? Is it a crazy and convoluted rabbit hole of plot strands, conspiracy, and the paranormal? Absolutely. However, Metal Gear Solid is also a title that set a new standard in video gaming. And I do mean a new standard as an umbrella term. It set a new standard in cinematic presentation, it set a new standard in sound design, and it set a new standard in terms of its approach to gameplay, with its focus on evasion mixed in with its creative and highly enjoyable boss fights. And then there's the story, Metal Gear Solid's ultimate legacy, the lore of which will only grow with every subsequent release. Moreover, Metal Gear Solid proved that even a game with so many other redeemable qualities can only be enhanced with such a brilliant story. Essentially, the story elevated what would have been a classic into the echelon of iconic, all-time great games.